Academic and it's theater and the place where they both meet.
We have
the
audience
and practices and
storytelling.
Initial
practices,
start with practices,
cultural
practices. Examples
of women sharing what it is
they
do, sharing how you do that.
There's no way you can ignore Latinos anymore.
Welcome all around the room.
Come
and see
and
talk about
it. What time is it now? Kenya?
Started out about different people and about different things.
A whole sea of phenomena.
Theater for everybody, yes, everybody.
That's it for TV done.
Has to do with the wooden person.
And indeed, my understanding of life, relationships, death
has already changed.
The Graduate Center, CUNY, and for taking time out on what actually seems like a warm day, and but I think it is really worth it. And as you know, we have a unique evening here. I think the work of artists, for very good reasons, stays in the center of what we look at the Siegel Center. And then also some artistic engagement, academic engagement, reflection on the art. But the curators, people who make the art happen, who put things together, who in the idea of Joseph Beuys are as artists as much as everybody else, because they create a social sculpture, a social context, a communication. Often their work is not really clear what they do, overlooked, and perhaps also not fully appreciated. And we have a moment right now in New York with the great PS122 organization, where it's a moment of transition, and it's a time to look at the past, the present, and the future. And these three curators who are now here with us, Mark and Vallejo and Jenny, so agree to be with us tonight and talk about their work. We also will have then a session with you, a Q&A later, and a little reception. So thank you all for coming. The Siegel Center bridges academia and professional theater, international and American theater, and the work of PS122, of course, always is there as a laboratory, a workshop that researchers, you know, what is going on. They think about what could be a salon for the theater of the 21st century. So we're gonna hear now a little bit more about the mechanics, how it works, how they work, and perhaps also what we might expect or what will come out, and look at those three different, how would one say, regimes, ways of curating it, and also the red thread that goes through it. So please do come over here, and again, thank you very much for coming. Maybe we put it a little bit. So again, first of all, welcome, and again, is thank you all for coming and taking taking time. But since it is a lot about the building itself, PS122, maybe we start with Mark. Mark, what does it mean to you? You have to be, since we're also recording it, you have
to. Oh, I have to talk into that.
Yes, okay. I'm sorry.
Well, you know, I need to recognize someone in the room.
Yes.
Catherine Wolpe. There she is. She was the head of the community space, 122, and kept that building open, helped open the doors, and kept it open for many, many years, all the way through my time there, and did incredible yeoman service. So I've spent many a cold morning, Saturday morning, in the middle of the unheated PS122, having board meetings with Catherine Wolpe.
So we wouldn't be here without her.
We cannot be here without her, yes. And she.
Thank you.
Yes, please. So what does it mean to me? It means PS122, Performance Space 122. And, yeah. And it... I was very lucky to be the first one to, or essentially the first one to be their executive director. I was appointed by Charlie Moulton, Tim Miller, and Charles Dennis, and they wanted me to just manage the space. Matter of fact, they wanted to call it Auditorium Projects at one point. And when I got there, I realized they hadn't incorporated. They didn't really have an official name or a board, and so I decided I was the executive director, and that it was going to be Performance Space 122, and we were off and running.
So what was your first day there? How did you connect in the very first?
My first day?
Hmm?
It started at Jonas Schimmel's with the assorted my board of three guys. And we had this weak coffee and, Jonas Schimmel's. And then I went up there. And when I walked in, John Byrne was mopping the floor. And then he started talking to me. I knew John before, but he sort of became basically my whisperer, the PS122 whisperer, essentially. And remained the core, the moral core of that place for a long time as well. John Byrne was a dancer and a performance maker, and one of the first of our group to succumb to AIDS.
And so maybe, since you mentioned that it was a community space first, so give us a little idea how, which we do not know the transition, it was a school, then it was most probably an empty building, it did get...
Yeah, it was a school, and it was squatted by community members and artists, and things like a Polish daycare center. Let's see. I'm trying to keep it short because I can go really long here. And the community wasn't that happy about it. There was the people that squatted it had to deal with a lot of noise from the outside of people wanting a different thing. They didn't want artists in there or something of that. But we managed to keep it going. There were some really hot things. There was a lot of, the first, before I even really got there, there was someone who came and there was a performance with a lot of ketchup bottles and they had thrown the ketchup all over the room. It looked like a complete bloody, it looked like Manson party. There was nothing there except when Charlie Moulton first moved in, they had tile on the floor, and he started ripping up the tile and found this incredible floor underneath, and so he started doing performances in that square of four tiles, Then the movie Fame came in 1979, and threw everyone out nicely, and use that space for the movie Fame, and you can see everything. My office used to be the office where they told the girl to go back to technical school. She'll never cut it as a dancer. One of the things they did is they put a whole bunch of the dancers in a loft, a storefront on, I think, North Moore Street, which turned into a party spot all summer, and people like Eric Bogosian, Peter Rose, Melissa Fenley, we're all working out of there. That party just kept going when we reopened, when the movie company moved out, and we moved back in. And the movie company, of course, had painted everything as sort of a old school style. They helped
it
us.
It wasn't old school.
Yeah. But they had given us this great floor. Yeah. And we started going. The guys, the artists, were... they were using it for their space, and they paid the rent, which was not much, but they paid the rent, and which actually basically covered the heat and electricity. And then to subsidize that, they started to rent it out on the weekends to help. And that you could also rent the clip lamps or the rheostat dimmer, if you wanted, or the home stereo system. Their career started moving along. They needed someone to run the place. I looked like I knew what was like. Actually, I looked not, the only person they knew that wasn't really dangerous to them. So I had no artistic ambition. And so they let me come in, and I started moving it along, basically as a rental space. And then I realized through NISCA and other people that helped me, going, okay, you're running an organization. This is what you got to do. And I realized I could get more money if I flipped the script, and we took more of the risk. So we were, you would, it was like 60% of the box office went to you, and 40% went to us after we managed to hit $300. And then it went on from there, and we began to guarantee fees. From the most part, for the most of my tenure there, there was always a little incentive. Like, you could get, like, if we, you could get it more of a percentage of the thing. But, and then we got the Jerome Foundation found us, and we started giving commissions. It was a going concern. It was really a community space, and actually, there were some people in the community who were a little pissed off that their rental space had left them. And I got a little grief from that, because they could rent it, and it was like their space. And you would actually, it was just given the keys. I was there, David Ferry, John Byrne was doing the books. David Ferry was the first person I really hired to do the lights. And I also hired Donna McAdams because she was taking pictures, and she took pictures from the every year that I was there, and into yours.
Yeah.
So it was a real, in a way, from that community space, it was a big jump, maybe the biggest one, you know, in a way, from what it was to what it became. But what was your idea? What was your vision? What did you see when you said, oh, did you right away see this would become that space? What was driving you to all this? Was really hard work and from day to day.
It was hard work. I mean, when I got the job, they said, we have, $7,000 to pay you. And that included what I was going to make in unemployment. So they really were paying me $150 a week. So we worked with that. I wish I could say I had a huge vision of many people and an international thing. I was going and basically feeding off a community. I was reflecting a community, working with a community to make things happen. I was trying to stay out of their way and make things as much as possible for them. And we were upgrading our performance systems, our lights and things. We were upgrading our press and our marketing. And it began to get a sort of a ground roll for it, and it became a place. It became like, oh, you're performing at PS122. We know what that is. I also was taking when we were in the rental place, I was curating the rentals. I was trying to get some sort of sense of what is a good place, so that the people that came to that place knew that it was going to have a certain integrity. But I had a really wide palette. We were doing things with capoeira dancers, and there were classes during the morning, there were rehearsals during the afternoon, and then we did performances at night, and the performances at night often had to happen at 9 o'clock because the dancers didn't get out until 6. But in the East Village, everyone was living around the corner anyway, and that wasn't such a problem. So I was just, I really felt that I was there to channel a community.
So, and if I understand right, I wasn't there, but it was like the place, in a way, what you created or what you absorbed. It was the New York place for New York artists,
yes.
And they would hang out on the floors and talk, so it became a community center in that sense, but for the New York performance maker. Was it organically that it happened? You said we don't want international people here, or that it was too early. How did that identity come out?
We started, I mean, it was always kind of an international community moving through the East Village anyway.
Living, I mean, you know, I would say people living in New York, yeah.
Yeah. And we started, or people that knew people, like the Tanzfabrik from Berlin did some of the early performances with us and all. We were, we're trying to create this. It was a lot about me not being the smartest one in the room. I wanted to be working with much more smarter and ambitious and artistically interesting people than myself. And I kept that going. And I kept trying to make possibilities for those people. And sometimes it was also a sort of a sandbox where you could fail. Failure was really big for us. It's like I had to do the elevator repair service like 3 or 4 times before I kind of felt like they knew what they were doing and I knew what they were doing. And so there was a lot of that rolling through.
Vallejo, for you, I mean, coming from Australia, having worked in Edinburgh Festival, how did you hear about PS122? How did it look like for you when you came here?
Well, I mean, I don't know where I heard of it first. It might have been in Australia. It was I was in Dublin, not Edinburgh, but that's right. But certainly, it's funny. There are venues that I've heard of, and PS might have been that, where you learn about them because you're watching videos of shows, and you start seeing certain columns or certain windows in all these videos of shows that you're watching, and you're like, where the fuck is that? And then so you learn about PS, and PS was a place which was a kind of externally a kind of crucible for American artists. You know, it was a place that everyone interesting had done something there, you know, and had frequently done many things there. It was a kind of legend. So at a certain point, I started getting to know some of the American scene, originally because the Worcester Group toured to Melbourne with the Hairy Ape in 2001, and they played a long run there, and I was the sort of artistic associate. I was programming the festival club and all the outdoor stuff, working for a guy called Jonathan Mills, and the Worcester Group came, and I kind of became one of their babysitters, which the Worcester Group at that time were a pretty... hard partying kind of bunch. So babysitting them was kind of a tall order, but I became very close friends with John Collins, from Elevator Repair Service, and Scott Shepherd, and Ari Fliakos, and Ariana Truman, and Reed Farrington, and Jim Finley, and a whole bunch of people who then, when I came to New York to work with a company called Synapse for a 3 months at the end of 2001, they kind of introduced me to the whole world here, and it was like they just started kicking open doors. And then I got the job in Dublin, and we started bringing people over. So we brought National Theatre of the USA and Banana Bag and Bodice, and then Radio Hole and a bunch of companies over to Ireland. And then at a certain point started getting to know Mark, and started getting to know a whole lot of people who worked here, and a whole lot of the artists and companies that worked here, and the choreographers. And some of the ideas that were kind of happening here. And then when Mark left, I sort of went, fuck it. I've always wanted to live in America. And threw my hat in the ring. So
you wrote an email or you had a call or what happened? How did
I think it was I sent a telegram and then wrote a letter. and then when they invented the fax machine, I sent one of them, unrolled it. No one, none of you would remember that. We'd run a conference in Dublin the year before, I remember, and it was this crazy thing that Olga Garay from the Duke Foundation had set up in Ireland, and everybody was there. It was like one of those scary rooms, you know, where you sort of, we'd organized this conference and showed them kind of a mountain of terrible Irish fringe theatre. But that was actually a huge introduction to me to the scene. I applied and came over. I think I might have gotten the job because I wasn't from here, because I kind of came in clean a little bit, and people didn't know. I didn't have lots of skeletons or whatever. I kind of could get away with stuff.
So when you came over and said, you know, I'm going to take it, or what did you see in PS122? What did you say, I'm going to do this, I would like to, what was driving you? What was your thing? You said, I would like to try that out.
Well, I came in and I said, I was really shocked at, it's funny, and you know, a whole lot of the international artists that you have had here and that were in that video at the beginning, I used to go around in the city and sort of go, well, what, you know, why hasn't Castorf or Castellucci or Martala or, you know, da 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 da. I had a sort of memorized list of, like, why haven't any of them come here? Or Pan Pan or whoever. And people would look at me blankly. They'd never heard of them. And I was like, oh, this is really interesting. And what it said to me was that you don't have to have been in New York to have had like an incredibly successful worldwide career. And I don't think that was always the case. And suddenly, at least in 2005, it felt very apparent that we were this huge city with enormous kind of, you know, that was talking a big game. But actually, we needed to do more to kind of participate in the worldwide scene. And so that was what I was saying I was going to do when I came in. And of course, you always say certain things in a job interview. And you say things when people ask you that question when you're going to come in. And I said I was going to do this and this and this. And interestingly, you know, and while you were talking, Mark, Lucy walked in, and I, you know, want to say kudos to Lucy Sexton. But I remember in my first gala, Lucy and a whole bunch of the people around you came in for an envelope stuffing session. And I don't know if it was deliberate, but we were sitting in the Mabou Mines studio there, and there was this coterie it was a kind of group of women who were all somehow, and I'd never really all, and it was Kyle, and it was you, and it was Sally, and it was all these people, and they'd all been there, and what I suddenly, I remember walking out of that room and realizing that a community had birthed the place and built it. And so I could come in with my, you know, well, I'm going to, you know, bring in all these international artists, and I'm going to globalize everything, and I'm going to be, you know, do this, and I'm going to, you know, create all these kind of particular curatorial agenda kind of things. And then willingly and productively, the sort of the local train in New York smacks you off the tracks and kind of takes you somewhere else. And you've sort of got to run with that. And that's one of the fascinating things about this place, I think, is it's a combination of what you want to do, and then and that is balanced out with a kind of an enormous sense of the responsibility that you carry as a salaried, funded person and organization to a community of artists that don't have that benefit.
It's also a little bit like playing Yankee Stadium, I think, after a while. People come going, oh, this is the boards where Eric Bogosian did his thing? Oh, really? Yeah.
I was going to say, you must have sold a lot more tickets than we did. It was like playing Yankee Stadium.
One section of that would keep us for the whole year. But, I mean, after a while, that good theater ghosts really made that room charged. And we would do these benefits, which were kind of legendary, 5 shows in 3 days, and with about 60 performers, but it would be everyone from Allen Ginsberg to Ann Carlson to Danny Hawk, and it was there was a whole community sort of really bought into this was their space. That was the deal.
Yeah, and figuring out how to change the ghosts and make space for new ones is always an interesting process. And, you know, I think Jenny's going to find that now.
So if we have, you know, a theme, it is, you know, from the squatted building, you know, to build it in a place that where you had to be. If you hadn't performed at PS122, you didn't really exist.
And you missed the exit somewhere because we did that.
You had to be there. It was part of it. And then it became, you know, internationally as you're renowned. And then also, you know, international work came here, and and things went also back and forth with you. You could also had your connections, you know, to the outside world. So On your radar, PS122, when did it appear first? What did you see, and now, where do you think the ship might go? How did it appear on your horizon? And you could choose many jobs where you would work actually in the art world or museum. You said, "I'm going to do PS122. Why?" And
on my radar, I believe when I lived in the East Village around 2008, 9, and would go and see shows there.
What did you see?
I remember that was way earlier when I actually came to New York and I was studying at NYU and I was in the performance studies department, and Karen Findlay, who's a professor there, she did a performance. That must have been 2002, 3, something
American
like that.
American Chestnut or something.
I don't remember what it was. I should actually look it up.
Did it involve a lot of honey?
Yeah, fluids.
Yeah, fluids. There were fluids involved, yes. That was probably Karen around 2002.
It was like post 9/11, so she talked a lot.
Yeah.
It was a lot about that. And then, just as a performance curator, of course, went and saw a lot of shows and a lot of choral. I very much, and up till this day, Ishmael Houston Jones, them, mm-hmm. was they redid it.
You're going to have to bring it back now. So
I will.
Sort of done.
I already asked him. Yeah. That really left everyone familiar with the piece, with
them,
Ishmael Houston Jones. And that left a huge impression on me. And still, I still consider in the 14 years that I've been watching a lot of performance in New York City, it's one of the best pieces I've seen. And talks about the AIDS epidemic and very early 86, something like that.
86.
Yeah. PS122 is on your radar. And then your other question was why?
Yeah. What attracts you to? What are you going to do? What do you see in it? What will you? I know it's in the very beginning, and often we do figure out why we do things, but still.
I think the moment where I was asked to apply for the job, and I just had a child.
And you was asked by the PS122 board?
By the search committee. There was a search committee. Someone called me, told me this job's opening up. And I just had he was barely 3 months old. And I remember he was like in the carrier. And I was first a little like, do I really need to become a director of a institution, and thinking about it. And then it took a much longer time for me to really interview our first set conversations. And then it was really the moment that I got a tour through the building, through the new spaces that were still under construction, and where I just thought like a space like that in the heart of Manhattan dedicated to performance art is something like that's an opportunity. It's like once in a lifetime. And I had been in my former job for maybe 5 years, so I was also getting already a little, routine.
Maybe tell a little bit, not everybody knows what you did or your former job.
I was before that at MoMA PS1, Contemporary Art Institution in Long Island City. And I was hired there five and a half years ago to build a performance program, a weekly performance program. So that's what I was doing there. And it was great, but it was just a challenge.
So in a way, the new space, that was the moment when things clicked in that new renovated, which we haven't seen yet, but we will see this year, this fall. And
then it's PS122 if you
history,
being
yeah.
asked, so I that's why I went to the interviews and did it and was wondering should I do it, but that was really the time that I knew that I really want to, I really want that job. And then I went for it. And I think, well, I think it's an interesting time to begin. I mean, I guess in New York City it's always an interesting time. But I think it's an interesting time for performance art. I think, you know, we all grapple with gentrification, artists not being able to live in the city, like the artists, like what Mark tells us, like the artists, if they don't have a rent-stabilized apartment, they cannot afford living in the neighborhood anymore, so the younger generation cannot live there anymore. Artist spaces have to move out of Manhattan. And I think it's a really, I mean, if we want New York City to stay the city that we love, then we need great public spaces. And performance, and especially theater, is such a important medium to come together, make work together, and spend time together. So that's actually, and also, maybe I should say, then I got this job offered the week that after the election, the Friday after the election. And then I just felt like I have to, like someone gives you, you know, a megaphone. And I felt like I had worked enough with artists in the city to have a good idea of what's needed. And
so what will you say in the megaphone? What will you, what do you?
I don't think I want to can boil it down to one statement, but I want to create or keep an institution that's open for artists first and foremost, and that becomes or is a space, a public space, as I said, where people come, spend time, see work, create work. And these spaces, they're just disappearing by the hour, in especially in Manhattan, but all over New York City.
Maybe for you guys coming from, you know, from the, all the work, all the time you spent, even dealing with the building, which we also should talk like as the little monster, you know, you had to keep feeding. What would you give her on the way? What, if I may ask, you know, what do you think? This is something that should be. Something to
well,
keep
know,
in mind.
You know, often arts administrators or consultants will draw these circles, and usually the artists inevitably, in a lot of presenting institutions, end up on the outer circle. But at PS122, they're the inner circle, which is a very privileged place. You know, we are doing this. I used to bring in international things to sort of shake the minds of the artists that I was working with. You know, like, you think you're so hot? Check this out. You haven't seen, you think you know everything? Look at Tim Mitchell's, you know, this kind of thing. And that creating that dialogue, which was a luxury, you know. And then people, they didn't know it, but the members or the people that came, they were just part of the making of that work, of the development of those artists.
Yeah. I always go back to something that I was on a random presenting trip in Colombia in about 2010, and Free Laysen, who ran a festival in Brussels called the Kunsten Festival des Arts, got up in front of the room and said, "Well, I hate these things, and I present artists, not shows." And I just sort of went, and everybody lost their minds. Every artist in the room lost their mind about it. And I sort of went, "Ah, that's really interesting." And then kind of went, all right, there's a motto to adopt, actually, because at a certain point, you know, and just even looking around this room, you know, Annie, for instance, sorry to pick on you, but, you know, Democracy in America, which was one of the very early commissions with me, started out as a version of the de Tocqueville and ended up as a kind of live eBay manifestation, you know, as an online auction thing. It's, you know, the work evolves, you know, you can't predict it, and you work with the people that you trust and the people that you love. So you're working with artists, not with necessarily determined or defined outcomes.
Yeah.
And you know, you've got to be comfortable with that indeterminacy.
I think even you can go further and say, as you said, you program for artists too. I mean, that's always the first audience. If my artist friends are interested, I know I'm on the right path. So I would even go that further.
Maybe to talk a bit also about the profession of, Mark started out still as a programmer. I think the computer, emerging computer world changed it perhaps, you know, to the curator, you know, because it became a different connotation to the work. But for all of you, you know, being a curator, how are the mechanics? How much time do you spend on with the artists? How much time you have to deal? How much time you plan ahead? How do you all create personally? How do you all create these programs? How do they come into being? And you are three highly accomplished curators and admired by the community. And so tell us a little bit, what is the craft really of that thing, what people also study or would like to do, and the reality is often so different, but what is it for you? What does it mean to be a curator?
Magician never tells.
Well, this is the seagull, and this is full of secrets, and normally and we wouldn't ask this, but you know.
It's
you know,
a rigorous scientific.
Yeah.
Can you, yeah.
I would say you put your hands on the artist, you take hands off, and there it goes, that's it.
Yeah.
You know, you just feel that thing. I don't know. It, you know, it's everybody's got their own sort of what is trust? What is what do I believe in the integrity of this person's process? That they'll turn up either a great mistake, or even an amazing piece, or both. You know, and so that was what I was trying to trust. And in this world, there's not scripts. There's you have to see things, you have to meet with people for it to roll before you decide to take a bet. Now, we had two theaters going full-time all year round. It was like Under the Radar all year round, like Coil all year round, which had a certain burnout factor to it. But
yeah,
but
you
we, could, we you know we could throw things up and like, okay, well, you have a great idea there, try it. I'm going to give you a weekend and enough money to hang yourself, go do it.
Yeah, I think when I started, we were doing 550 curtains.
Possibly.
Which is like how many different events each year. And by the time I was done, I think we were doing 100. So like one of the changes between you and I was that sort of, we started just doing less with more.
Yeah. Well, you actually, I mean, you focused on getting more money to the artists in paying better and more competitive fees, which was really important. And I think we would have gone there, but we had not got there yet. You know, it was still very grassrootsy in that way.
But you lose something. We lost something in doing that, you know, which was some of that freedom, and that, you know, it became much harder to get a gig, and to there wasn't that opportunity just to throw it on the wall and see if it stuck in the same way.
Yeah.
But to go back as that professional, the curator, you know, what are the moments, you know, you know what to do? How do you how do you program? How far in advance do you do? Is it traveling that inspires the talks? Is it social interactions with the artist? So how do you create the work you create?
You know,
lots of conversations.
Lots of conversations and seeing things, which sometimes I call fishing. I go on fishing trips, you know, to see what's out there.
And half the time, the fishing trips, it might just be justifying the inordinate amount of time I spent on the road, but half the time, the fishing trips aren't necessarily. You don't see what you're going to bring. You see things and you're like, oh, this is happening. This is an idea set that's happening over here. All right. And then start thinking about who's going to sort of address that here. And I mean, we would, the sort of my always thing was like, is it going to do something to me that hasn't happened before? You know, was frequently my kind of mental question. But it, again, a lot of the time, it's I mean, for me, I always thought that I was too reactive. So this is how did it happen? It happened by reacting to the ideas that people were bringing to you, and kind of going, that sounds amazing. I've never heard anybody come up with that, but let's do that. And what, you know, it didn't fit any theme or anything that we were, you know, just was like, sounded amazing. And it was someone you trusted to have integrity in how they were going to address it. And then hopefully it was someone that you think thought also could deliver a really interesting experience for an audience. But my sort of criticisms of, because I'm always like, every time the impossibility of answering that question is that every time I think of, well, this is what we did, or this is what I did, or this is one of my rules, it's like I can think of every time I broke that rule. And any one of the staff sitting over there would sort of agree, I think, that was sort of happening all the time. What am I trying to say? Sorry. It's some sort of balancing act between having an idea or having something where you're looking for someone to talk about the war, or you're looking for someone to talk about the return to populism, or you're responding to that. You know, there's been a remarkably little work, for instance, about the fact that we've been at war for 16 years.
True.
You know, and we haven't also set out to drive that. So there's that, you know, why isn't, so curatorially, I think that's a lack. We've missed out. So I don't know. It's easier to say what we didn't do than what we do sometimes.
Yeah, I have a different process. I'm expecting artists to tell me what they're interested in. And that comes out each time. So not, and they may be dealing with this 16 years long war, but we may not get that till, you know, from a while. I consider the best theater piece about World War II to be Waiting for Godot, when that was up in 1954. So I think it takes a while, especially in live arts, for this stuff to come through the system. And live arts is a slow and hard process. I've never felt more impotent than at 9/11. I had a huge room, but the best performance was happening on the street. The best actions were happening on the street. There was nothing that could touch it.
That's it. I felt exactly the same during Occupy.
Yeah.
As someone running a progressive, supposedly incredibly forward organization that was leading the sort of ideas of the country and blah, blah, blah. And then you're sitting in your window watching all your friends and everybody march down the street, and they're doing really shit puppetry. But also, which is in itself a problem. But the bigger problem for us was that none of the things that we were doing artistically had any bearing on what they were, how they were choosing to manifest a protest or express, or you know what I mean? And that was suddenly, that was a huge wake-up call for me personally, was the failure for us to be in the front of that, and for people to know that we were, and you know, that, and I think many of the artists that we were working with had ideas but we'd failed to communicate out to a larger audience, or we'd failed to locate ourselves. I'd failed to locate us properly at the front of that.
Although I think some of the later, some of the pieces I can't name them, but the people that were coming from Occupy, who did Occupy, and a couple years later, we were seeing works that were very much informed by that, and very rich discussions of that, you know, of the ideas, of the deeper ideas, the deeper emotions involved in that, coming out through pieces at PS122.
I hope so, because that was one of the, that was something that where I, that failure really struck me, that we should fucking fix that. No, I know, but I mean, you know, fix the lack in the programming. Sorry, it's harder for you because you haven't got stuff to lacerate yourself with yet.
As a question out, I mean, I think actually Claire Bishop, who also teaches here, and in an interview, was an article about Oprah, the great curator, actually, she did say, you know, what she didn't like, that the in the art world, it's moving so fast. It's superficial. It doesn't go deep anymore. It's a big, hungry machine, and you have to feed it. And so what are your reactions? How will you react? What do you think of this? Is there something that happens also in our world? Will it be more of this? Will it be less? Or massive amount of things we do, so which always have been here. How can an organization or can a place like PS react to that?
To feeding the beast, not feeding the beast. Well, maybe with working with different time dimensions, like working on projects that actually take way longer. I met with an artist today, for example, and she told me, you know, I don't think I'll be ready before 2019, and to say that's completely fine. Oh, sorry. So, you know, to give things also time. To work, I found working intergenerationally very rewarding. So, you know, probably the criticism, I don't know when Claire said that, but it's probably also that it's also about the next new thing, the next young, hip artist, that everyone all of a sudden wants to commission the same person. So, you know, work intergenerationally, like, it's always tricky with collaborations. You don't want to enforce them, but you can encourage them. Often artists love doing that. And maybe also work with artists repeatedly, not just, which I think actually the performing arts world is so much better than the visual art world. Like with institutions, they often feel like if they've done a show or even just a small project with an artist, then we can't show them, even in the same town, can't show them for the next 10 years. That's a little exaggerated, but so I, not being afraid of that, just slow things down. I think there are a lot of artists that work, like performance artists, that actually work with slowing things down, time, giving things time. It's one strategy.
And then there's groups like Dance Noise that would do it the next day.
Yes, know, and that's like important
come
too.
Come out and blow it up, you know?
That's important too. I think it's also, that's one of the great things about, can be the great things about performance art, that you can react actually quite quickly. And that's something with an institution, you know, the bigger you get, the more red tape there is, the harder that gets. As Vallejo said, you know, we're not maybe able to react so quickly as you were. But I would hope that we would stay that way.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually one thing that I find important.
Vallejo. Well, I think one of the questions you're asking was about, you know, the mechanisms and the mechanics and da da da. One of the things we were talking about before was just like, you spend very little of your time curating. The reality is,
yes.
You know,
how much little? How much, let's say 100%. What do you think? How much is
20? 20. I don't know.
What is the moment when you curate? Anyway,
I don't know. But even just like directly working on the art or the with the art.
Working
I don't
with
know.
The
25.
Artists,
I don't
yeah.
know.
Yeah.
And then it's sort of it's institutional stuff. It's staff and it's fundraising and it's answering emails and it's, you know.
Also the building in a way so has a physical building. Presence. Maybe you talk a little bit, all of you will have Vallejo speak, but also all of you dealt with it as a little monster, I guess.
Yeah, it was a monster.
Tell a bit how do you engage, people say artists with the space itself, how does it manifest itself for you guys in your daily work?
Well, they tell me, the spaces tell me often what's supposed to be there. You know, one of the nicest, best things about working at 122 is after a long night, you know, it's 1 a.m, you finally finish the grant, and you go into that room, and you see it, and you remember the other performances that were there, and you think of the performances that you might want to do, And then things began. I swear that I'm a little kooky about this, but it begins to speak to you. You know, and in that room also, now it's different because it's such an amazing multi-purpose room. That room always had four columns. And it always, you couldn't do everything. The room, you had to deal with the room. Everything was very site-specific, so you couldn't do everything. I wanted to do things. I wanted to do, like, a Castellucci where I could have a big room or something like that. And I felt like that New York needed a Joyce Theater for performance. But we don't have one, you know. And I think we tried. That's one of the things I'm trying to answer when I'm doing Under the Radar. Which is only for, like, you know, 12 days. Same with you. So to give those people access to a theater that might have a fly space or a width, you know. And in Europe, they have those. And they have festivals that do those, but they also have producing organizations that constantly are dealing with these rooms that can be more generic or, you know.
Well, the theater system there deals with change a lot better than, you know, ours. I mean, yeah. Like, you know, the big theaters, you know, will employ, will bring those art radical, profoundly, you know, people who are fucking with time or changing kind of, you know, rather than sort of here, even in New York City, the big non-profit producing theaters are, you know, still doing.
But Vallejo also.
But you're in there though. I mean, you're the only voice of reason.
A question for you: You left Dublin, you came here to create work at PS, and then it got closed. Many years, actually, you dealt with creating a new building, and then you're leaving when it comes. But tell us about what does that all mean for you, and how is that part of your work as a curator? How did you struggle with that and?
Well, the building was held together with duct tape and string, you know.
A bit closer.
Yeah. The building was held together with duct tape and string, and there was, it wasn't very safe. It was full of rats. It was full of, you know, it was tricky, and it was a space that was also made. That manifested and became what it was, became the thing that was 122, in the work that Mark had put in there, which was lower tech than the work we were doing and needed different, you know, was Spalding Gray behind a desk or Boghossian kind of roaming the stage like a feral animal or, you know, particular kind of choreographers who, you know, worked, you know, if they weren't knocking themselves out on them, were working around those columns. And then the people we were bringing, that I wanted to bring in, needed different kinds of things and wanted to, and at a certain point toward the end of your tenure, I think the seating had gotten fixed.
Yes, that was.
And I often wonder if that was a mistake.
It was a total mistake.
Because the seating risers became very hard to move, and we also then started storing things. We were like the mice then. We were like, and you know, the tunnel was full of stuff. Derek's tunnel. Was full of stuff, and so
the tech had gotten so sophisticated.
Yeah,
what
people wanted,
you needed
was
that.
They didn't just need projectors; they needed DLP projectors, and they needed this kind of lighting system and this kind of sound. So suddenly, it was like, all right, we need a space that's 24 feet to grid that can seat 200 people and it doesn't have columns in the middle of the stage. And that's what, and New York City didn't have one of them. It didn't have a Joyce Theater for performance. It didn't have a place like that. And I thought, here's an opportunity. Here's something
we can do.
You made a
decision. You talked to the board, say, we need to change, we need to close down, we need to raise money. Was that?
Yeah, just one day we just decided to shut it down. No, and then the city needed to renovate the building. You know, it wasn't up to code. And East Village real estate's vastly expensive. So at a certain point, I think, I mean, I don't know what the machinations were in the city. We'd hired a lobbyist to go and lobby the city for capital money. Everybody used to have lobbyists. And, you know, you'd go and sit with this kind of enormous guy wearing braces, suspenders in a diner while he ate a double bacon cheese, grilled cheese sandwich and said, how much do you want? And we were like, 800,000? And he went, ugh.
I'll make it 1.2. And we're like, okay. And there came a check for 1.2 million. It was like the city was, this was like, I was like, oh my God.
Welcome
like
to New York.
A movie from the 20s. And then there was a process where we went, and Anne Denon, who was the executive director then, kind of said, you know, we need to, she's about yay high and kind of a southerner, and she talks slow and kind of like, she's like, we need to go in and get this building renovated. And I was like, all right, fuck it, let's go. And so we start going for more. And then, you know, it started out being $20 million or something to get all the asbestos and the lead out. And then it just snowballs. And then suddenly, you know, this here we are many years later. And, to be honest, if I'd known that we would not be in the building now, I would never have started the process.
How many years was it? Four years?
Well,
five?
We started moving. The outside got renovated. The scaffolding that had been on there for 10 years to protect pedestrians from being hit in the head by pieces of the facade falling off got taken down. Partly because it had been there so long that it was more unsafe than the facade. I remember watching one of those wooden panels blow off in a storm and spiral over First Avenue and then land in the middle of First Avenue and just think if that had gone through a windscreen. And I just wanted to run away. And then it came down and then another scaff went up and they replaced all the windows and made the outside look pretty like it looks now and got rid of the lead and the asbestos. And that was like 2008 to 10. And then it was all hunky-dory for about a year. And then the interior process started. And that had been years of lobbying and arguing and debating how much money it was going to be. And the city allocates money to something and then starts it about 4 years later. And choosing architects and, you know, blah, blah, blah. And so it started 2 years later than it was supposed to. We moved out in 2011, I think, because we were so sick of waiting for it to start. And they kept changing when it was going to start. So at a certain point, we were like, fuck it, and we left. And we rented the theatre to Silence of the Lambs, the musical, which did pretty well for about a year and actually supported a whole moving process. And we said, you know, this is really going to be amazingly positive because there was a lack of work that was happening in different spaces that was kind of engaging audiences in different ways. We were all kind of junkies of box office revenue. So we needed to sell tickets and we needed to have a longer run. And the way New York values theatre conventionally is by the length of its run is how you measure its success. And we sort of went, nah, we're going to do something different and we're going to start putting work into different kind of spaces and different kinds of sites. And we're going to make ourselves this mobile presenting thing, we really saw that as it being a kind of a huge adventure. And it was an amazing thing because we were able to sit down with an artist and say, well, where do you want to do it? A cathedral. All right, well, let's go to St. John the Divine. And we went up there or a warehouse in the Lower East Side or a subway tunnel or a wherever. And that was hugely fun. But then managing the process of getting the building going and value engineering, which is not a term I ever want to hear again, and just doing that became more and more tiring and exhausting. But I think, you know, I'm really proud of what we did while we were out. And then we made ourselves an organization that continuously worked in partnership with many of the people who are in this room, in fact. For presenting and for using their spaces or, you know, putting something else with them in another third space, you know, and doing things that weren't possible for us before. And it was great fun. It was really great fun. It was a lot more work, but it was great fun.
So the renovation, if I understand right, was more expensive than St. Anne's Warehouse, by the numbers. We once had a discussion here, like by a million or something. But was it worth that? Do you feel it all, it for all of you? I mean, you are now showing... You just said today you gave a tour. I don't know how many tours you gave, but was it worth it? Is it? Will it be what it's going to be?
It's up to her. Yeah.
I think so. Yeah, it's gorgeous. I mean, Vallejo did an amazing job.
Very,
And you're all going to see it, and yeah. I'm sure most of you completely agree.
It's going to be a really, it's going to be a very new PS122. It's not going to look at all like the old PS122. It has so many more things that can happen there. It has, you know, actual bathrooms where you don't have to like it, that are amazing.
So many.
Huh?
So many
of them. So, and they're all gender neutral. It's great. But, so I'm so excited. It's going to be a completely new world. I think of it as kind of a completely blank slate, you know?
It's really, for those of some, I don't, some of you might have been in there, but it does look pretty nice.
Yeah.
It's like the windows all over a theater, you know? It's things that aren't in theaters are there. And the height is really special. Mm-hmm. It's on the roof now, if you didn't know that. The new theaters are on the roof. And they are 24 feet high.
And you really feel like you're in downtown, like in the city, one of the most gorgeous views of downtown. Yeah. Feels still, though, very East Village. Yeah.
Now, cocktail hour is going to be really important for this building. watching the sun go down is going to be one of the harder competitions for whoever's performing there that night.
I'm hoping that... And as the ex-artistic director now, I can say this, that hopefully there'll also be a kind of cafe bar in the courtyard that is going to be something to go whether you're seeing a show or not. You know, like one of the things we don't do in New York is go to the theater to be in the building whether we're seeing the show or not. We don't go there for lunch or to sort of, you know, be part of the culture. We go in and then we leave, you know, and that always used to drive me crazy. And so there's going to be a really great sense in this new building of it somewhere that's open, that opens at 9 a.m. and closes after the show's finished. It's not somewhere where you have to go in through a big steel gate and then into a red door which takes you into a stairwell anymore. Not that there was anything wrong with that.
No.
It's like a minefield, this panel.
Maybe we should slowly open it up. Maybe Brad, if you can, you know, give some light to the audience. We have a mic, but maybe also one last question. Will there be an expectation? You know, often their story is more money is being raised, things are more expensive, the board, you know, members change, that we need to have revenues, we need to have then shows, it has to be reviewed, or they have to win something. Is there a feeling, is there some pressure, or is there something different, or do you think it will be always the PS122 way? What do your sensors pick up?
I mean, we need to bring in money to open the doors and pay the artist, and so there's definitely pressure, but I don't think much more than any of you had. I mean, that's just the pressure you live with as a executive director of an institution. The board's been very supportive and so far very open. I mean, they want to see a balanced budget, but that's normal and to be expected. I think so far it's people are open for.
I mean, I think it's tricky in New York. Sorry. It's tricky in New York now because we're in Lower Manhattan and there's a perception that it's a saturated place full of things, and the priority has shifted for a lot of funders and individual givers but particularly institutional funders into places that appear or seem more deserving or more needing. And particularly in the current political climate and particularly given the failings, I think, of American government, that, you know, how can you support PS122 if no one's funding schools or hospitals properly? And that debate is unfortunately having to be had over and over again now. So I think the funding environment is more challenging. But, I mean, I wasn't here. I don't know when the golden age was. It was sort of just before wherever you are now, always, wherever I've been. But, you know, I think that the big challenge that I think I was, one of the things that we were always struggling with, and I suspect that you will find as well, is that there is the articulating why PS122 has to exist. Because the question that I was always sort of, no one ever says it, but the question is always, well, what happens if you don't? You know, New York's just fine. You know, it's not like we're the only ones in a you know, poverty-ridden neighborhood anymore. You know, the East Village is full of the kind of liberal left-wing elite. And so what you know, like, why do they need, why should we fund
there
that?
There are not that many spaces that are fully dedicated to artists and experimental work. I think that's, I mean, so far I've been, the 2 months that I've been there, I've been able to make that argument pretty easily. And people understand and agree, so.
Phew.
They're not just because some board members might be in the audience, right? You say that. I'm just kidding, but it's some more comments. But I think Mark and Vallejo and Jenny did say, you know, especially for those two, how did PS122 do? How was PS122 do? They said normally, you know, things get reviewed. You do a piece, you write a. Have a show, you know, you get some feedback. It's tough, you know, when no one reviews a festival a year or a season. But what did it all, as an opening question, if that's fair to say, what did it all mean to you and in certain moments, and what do you expect from it? Which just might be very important for also for Jenny to hear. So maybe you show.
There's actually no board members here. Where are they?
You can speak freely.
Yes, okay.
Hi, it's Lucy. Performed at PS many times and was on the board for a long time. I think the most interesting thing was the thing when you said about we used to be 550 and then it's 100 number of shows per year. And that was right, because the PS shifts what it is, what it needs to be. The beginning, it needs to be this responsive, everybody has it, everybody owns it. And we can all get romantic about that time, but I never was. I always was like, okay, now we're into this next thing. You have the ability to offer more resources to artists. We can go to lots of small spaces and do, you know, a quick show with no resources and have fun and da-da-da. But PS then, you know, in Dunder Vallejo could offer something else, and that was correct. And also you did it outside the building a lot, which was great because it sort of brought into focus like, oh, that's this idea of PS122 that stays even when it's outside. So, you know, I think it's a fantastic moment that you're coming back in with a new director to this new version of the space. And great what you said, Jenny, about it being, yeah, there's not so much in Manhattan. Like, we need also places to gather in the center of Manhattan. I mean, in the center of the city, which is still Manhattan, because we live so in many different places now. And there's not that so many places to actually gather. What I also think, and what I put out to you, Jenny, as a question, and even if you don't have answers to, but just think, like, to think into the future, I think the next thing of, like, growing up as a space is also about being more articulate about, you know, like, you guys could be very like, well, we booked because I touched somebody's hand, and I liked them, and I got drunk with them, and I knew they might do something interesting. We now need something, I think, that says, oh no, we do this kind of work, and if you want to work here, come and, you know, this is what I want to use my megaphone for, and I want stuff that will come in. So to think about that vision more articulate, and then also I think the open question is, of course, what is the relationship to the neighborhood? Is there a relationship to the neighborhood, or is it a space of the world, a space of the city, the way it sort of grew into with Vallejo?
Well, there's one or two big ideas that I have now, and I'm still, you know, talking to a lot of people. I have many, many meetings every day, so I'm still learning every day. But for one, I would really like to start programming thematically, which means that we will have two seasons, and each season will pick a theme, or we pick a theme for the season. And then that theme will be fairly broad. And then bring in artists, and they can be, you know, definitely, of course, from theater, dance, but also could be also a lecture or a music performance that somehow relates to that theme. So, and there has many reasons, but one being not being arbitrary, but you know, I can tell an artist who asks me, so why this artist and not me, is, you know, because it's part of this season and let's have a conversation about all the other ideas we have. And the other idea was, we talked about being like a, you mentioned the word social sculpture, like the Boise in town. So really, I really feel there's such a vacuum, especially in the East Village, you know, that used to be the space where artists hang out, create, interact from different backgrounds, different media. And I have no illusions that we can recreate the old East Village, but really to create a space that is open to, first of all, artists, but then also the larger immediate community in the East Village that still is there. We, you know, there's the, for example, the projects 5-6 blocks away, and we do have a connection with the AIDS Community Center that work a lot with them. So how do we bring them in? And to answer the first theme that we decided to program around is actually the East Village and the history of it, and the performance history of it, and the history of the building itself, maybe even before it was Performance Space 122, when it still was a school. So I'm actually, that's what I'm doing all day long if I'm not fundraising and taking, organizing galas, is talking to people and see like what, you know, what comes to mind when you hear PS 122, who are the communities that we've been talking to, and how can we create this building to be more open and not, you know, obviously bringing on shows and having curtains is our still our number one endeavor, but also how do we bring in people during the day? So the restaurant will be very important, but also many other things that maybe a little too early to talk about, but that's, I mean, that's a very important question, yeah.
It's a restaurant now, I like that.
Any other question? What would you expect? What would you like to see, or, but we could hit the mic, 1 second.
So this is actually referring back to your first question, and I just want to say that I saw Ron Athney do that piercing performance a PS122, and I have to say my life was never the same after that.
He's actually on, we're talking.
I mean, but that was just really something. So that's, you know, I wonder, that kind of stuff is going on, but it's not going on in that area anymore, I would say, is the best way to say it. And I'm curious if PS122 can encompass and still be like that. That's all.
I have great hopes that it will. I think that that space can do it. And Jenny's really smart about these things. I'm glad you got to see that performance. It was so.
You know, I'm Norman Frisch, and I was also one of the people around in the early days of 122. And it's interesting because in a lot of discussions about 122, that I engage in person, online, and so on, a lot of people, as we did tonight, refer back to work in the early and mid 80s as being very kind of essential work in their own development as an audience member, as an artist, as presenters. And you all talked about the kind of relationship between a space and what's happening outside on the street. And of course, that was the moment at the, you know, onset and the development of the AIDS crisis when PS122 was exactly that interior space to what was happening outside on the street and in people's homes and in people's lives, and where ACT UP was meeting at Cooper Union. It was a part of a social event. And you all kind of intuit that there should be a connection between neighborhood spaces like PS122 and what is happening on the street, but no one can quite identify what that relationship could be, because by the time you observe it out your window, you're already programmed a year and a half ahead of time. So the question is, are there things happening on the street that we as programmers simply aren't seeing or aren't sufficiently ahead of the curve? Or is it the nature of such spaces as they age that they cannot be immediately responsive and they're always thinking 2 years ahead, and by the time that 2 years rolls around, there's some new thing happening on the street? Is that simply a dilemma of programming spaces at this size, budget, and planning complexity?
Yes, I think it's also a part of aging, becoming, you know, I mean, personally, but also institutions age too, and hopefully get a little bit more mature or bigger. So I think the spaces that you talk about, they still exist. They just don't exist, unfortunately, in Manhattan or downtown Manhattan anymore. And what I tried to say earlier, I think, yes, if we want to do big commissions and support artists in that way and also show, you know, bigger, more ambitious shows to our audiences, we have to plan ahead. However, I think there will always be some space, or we should always leave some space for doing more ad hoc reactive things, for sure. And to answer your other question about the street, just one example just came to me that for this first season, we're actually talking to a girl skateboard group, because East Village is also a place for skateboard, or has been a place for skateboarding, and all these spaces are also disappearing. So there's this girl skateboard group, Las Brujas, and we're talking to them to actually come and build a mini ramp, and this way to bring the street into the building. It's one of many ideas, but so I think it's still possible. I don't think why it has to be exclusive.
It's hard though. I mean, the city. There was a sense that I had when I arrived that the city was changing faster than we could. Yep. You know, and so how do we get ahead of the city, and how do you do that? I don't know that we've ever got the answer. Some of it, I think, is probably just making peace with the fact that suddenly, you know, we're an institution and so we're a bit slower, and there are other places. You know, I mean, think about when I arrived in New York, the chocolate factory didn't exist. You know, there were a whole lot of places that the invisible dog didn't exist, all these places that now are really considered very core to kind of the gestalt or whatever, the foment of what's happening.
Spaces that don't support artists now.
That's right. They don't have the money.
Financially.
They are spaces. But I mean, like, they've actually become spaces that do. They've become, that's the chocolate factory, for instance, has become a space that does. You know, they evolve into something else. So I guess I'm just saying that by way of saying that, you know, there is constantly another generation of places and other locations that are happening around you. And I think trying to be them after you've been around for 30 years is a fool's errand, you know. You've got to accept that you evolve and change into something else.
Although, you know, I work with an institution now that tries to keep itself fluid. I mean, that's one reason that 122 got up to like 500 things is that we kept jumping on those ideas that would bounce up and go, oh, this is not in the season, but it has to be. So how do you feel about midnight? You know. yeah. You know, and there's...
I remember having those fights with the people who are working at PS. Yeah, and no, like, there's we'll the tell thing. You how we're fucking real, mate.
We're, yeah.
The production team.
No, and but, you know, at the public, we're trying to build up our muscles to handle our particular penchant for jumping on ideas and creating a forum or creating a show really quickly. And that's a work in progress, but the fluidity is really important. And I think it's really important for institutions now. And trying to keep an institution from growing moss, really a full-time job.
Yeah, I mean, there are lots of ideas about how to run institutions now that I think are changing that'll answer some of those questions. You know, does it need to be a single curator or a single artistic director? Is that distributed somehow? You know, how do you give up the model historically, particularly in the States, was that it was someone who looked like Mark or I sitting at the head of an organization, kind of being the sort of figurehead gatekeeper. And I think that model is changing really and needs to change and is and has. And I think, yeah.
You know, when I got the job, Stephanie Skura, who's performing this weekend, if anyone can go see her stuff at Roulette.
Midweek,
she's this week. She said, Mark Russell, next best thing to a girl. So, and you know, finally we have a girl curious.
Next,
it's not just the quality, it's the quantity. Places like 122, we used to go up to the roof, we used to have picnics, it was fabulous. But the variety of dance is gone, and I don't think that it's going to come back. I think that they're not set up to say, hey, we can just throw this away and go on another tack.
Thank you. Another remark or thought in the middle here.
I just wanted to say that I think the East Village is a rather unique place in a couple of respects. One is the variety of immigrants that settled at least for some time, and some of them, their cultural institutions are still there, such as the Ukrainians, Polish. There's a New Yorican cafe now. There's a new museum, a new group called Lowy Sida that I've been in touch with. So you have a variety of cultural backgrounds. But you also, there are cultural institutions that have been going on for a long time. Third Street Music School is close to me. St. Mark's Church has dance and poetry, arts organizations as part. Theater for the New City is on First Avenue, a block away. There are always, under St. Mark's, there are a lot of, you need the small venues, and I know things are going to change, but some of the old things are nice too. So,
I mean, watching the three of you is like watching the you know, late stage market capitalism happen. You know, I mean, I'm serious. PS122 couldn't have started if we couldn't afford to live on $150 a week then, because real estate was affordable, because we lived and squatted in affordable housing. And in those days, the East Village really was an ethnic neighborhood. It isn't anymore. There's a couple of ethnic restaurants left, and I have an office in the Ukrainian home, and the only Ukrainian in that whole building is the landlord. So no one can, yeah, but Veselka's not, you know, but it's the third generation, and he doesn't speak Ukrainian. So, like, it's, they can't, people can't afford it. Anyway, what I guess I want to say is that in terms of the future, the idea that Mark had said in the beginning of wishing there was a Joyce for experimental work, for performance art, etc., that feels really fantastic to me. And I, you know, Vallejo, I want to bow to you for getting that done. I'm not kidding. And I just feel like we don't have to do what these guys did. It's not relevant to what's going on in the street in the East Village. In the East Village, it's mostly rich people that live there. Yeah. And that's okay. That's what it is. So how are they? And they need to be invited, for God's sake. And they need to see Ron Athey. And they need, or whoever is the next Ron Athey. So to think about bringing the street of that neighborhood into, not that there aren't people who, there's still people who live in rent-stabilized apartments, but we're few and far between. And so I feel really excited about the idea of there being a kind of palace for experimental work. And it's moment-to-moment response. It would be great if it could moment-to-moment response to what's really going on the streets in the East Village, which is noise pollution, things that affect people in different ways. So I just say brava to you, go get them, and bring those folks in to see the kind of work that they're not going to see anywhere else.
I came back to the city in 84. I grew up in New York. And I always gravitated to PS122. The hothouse dances on Sunday just tickled my imagination. I love being surprised. I love coming to 122 and not knowing what I was going to see and walk away in complete awe. I mean, it was just... And then one time I came to Mark and said, Mark, I have an idea about doing taking the Lower East Side performance art uptown. And he said, oh, that's a good idea, go do it. And so we did it. And then we had people come, and then we went out on the street and had a parade of the people from the audience to wherever we went to. But I love the social sculpture nature of the community, the life, the PS122. And I hope you feed off of that. You may not have the community that we had in the 80s, 90s, and earlier, but you might find just little sparks here and there. And I wish you luck on that.
There's still pretty good people living in this town, I think.
The other thing, which maybe ties together some of it, what Norm was saying and you were saying, there's other things you do in a theater besides performance, and PS122 always did, right? It's a center. We had funerals there. That's what made it in the AIDS days. So it was this, served this other purpose. You have had these long table discussions and this engagement with the political sphere of New York that I think is really important, and I think that will continue to be important as we try to advocate for things like an affordable city and a city that still has creativity in it and that we can still live in. And that will also be a role that simply by having spaces for people to gather in, it can serve that purpose.
You know, PS122 was started by activists, mm-hmm. and I think that's deeply baked into that street. It was the last public school that was on a corner. But I sort of was taught by the activists that were there when I came to be a resident at PS122. But I really feel that even now, with its change, its sort of makeover, they're still, that's very, matter of fact, it's even more, because it's a little bit even more open to people coming in a certain way. So it's, I'm really looking forward to it.
Actually, the entrance is now really, you can walk in straight from the street into the courtyard. So I think even architecturally, it's way more open. And there's an elevator, very important, yeah.
Yeah, I just wanted to go back to a point that you made, Vallejo, about when you first began and had these sort of international ambitions and then found yourself balancing that with the very rich immediate community and those two things. And it, I mean, I think it's quite apparent that that will kind of remain, you know, a big part of the future. I mean, I just wanted to touch a bit back on that international purview, because everyone, certainly in my networks in Europe, are like so looking forward to PS122 opening. You know, they're all always saying, is it open yet? What's it look like? Who's Jenny? What's she going to do? And so there's a lot of excitement around the sort of new era of the building. And I mean, it's that, you know, that sort of legendary status that you two spoke about is still very much alive. You know, anyone creating performance work or theater that's you know, anything outside of the conventions, and want to show their work in New York, you know, the first place that they always say is like, well, where would you go in New York? It's like, oh, well, PS122, who do I get in touch with there, you know? So it's still very much a touchstone. So it's exciting for people in New York and very much abroad as well.
I mean, I have all attention, and I hope you're going to help me cause to bring international work, yeah. So
one of the nicest things about the international purview piece was actually, I don't remember when the first one was, maybe it was 2010 or 11, but I think with your help, actually, when you were working at the Arts Council, Solette, but starting an international program of taking American work overseas, which was an evolution of something that Mark had done with a thing called field trips, which went to Philly and Austin and I don't know where else. But
Manchester. And
oh, I didn't know it had gone to Manchester. Oh, that's right. Like, fuck. You always think you've done it first.
I mean, how you probably could tell from my accent, I'm originally from Europe, from Germany. So I grew up in Berlin, with Berlin theater, and very influenced by that. So very looking forward to bring in international works, for sure.
So many of the great artists who've changed the scene here have been artists that are also profoundly connected to the rest of the world, and in ways that we aren't even, you know, and who do it by going and performing everywhere else, and not just in Western Europe, but in Asia or in, you know, Latin America and other places as well. And that dialogue is global now, but the funny thing about theatre is that, you know, almost all the time it happens in a room with a group of people. So it's profoundly local, and it has to be. Although, you know, maybe it doesn't, maybe it can be delivered some other way. So that tension is always really interesting, I think, and I think that, you know, I hope PS exploits that or explores it or whatever, the, you know, tries to crack that problem open.
And I think perhaps that is also a good moment, you know, to end this. Even I think we could go over and do longer. We'll have a little reception here. Maybe if you guys stay for 10, 15, 20 more minutes to ask some questions. It is a great thing now in your hands, as you have a big history. A lot of people are watching. I think we are very excited. I think it's great that you also built some snowmen. I think the great Carl Valentin said that theater is like a snowman. You built it, and then it kind of melts from last year. You have a photo, maybe, but it's not there, but you build a new one. And so we really wish you all the best. I think many people in the rooms and everybody here, you know, there's a lot of love for the building, for the work, for the legacy, and we're all there to support. And it will be also part of our history, and as it always has been. So thank you for coming. Thank you, guys. And all the best for whatever will come. Thank you.